Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to you to the virtual portals of Meher Chand Mahajan DAV College for Women, Chandigarh. Established under the auspices of the DAV College Managing Committee, New Delhi, a mettlesome organization with a glorious history of dedication to the spread of quality education, this college stands tall as a premier institution of higher education for women in North India. It is in fact a living tribute to the everlasting memory of a legal luminary and visionary, Justice Meher Chand Mahajan, the third Chief Justice of India, for his contribution to the cause of education and social reform. Ever since its foundation stone was laid by the then Vice President of India, Shri V.V. Giri, in 1968, this multi-faculty postgraduate institution has enjoyed a glorious odyssey studded with numerous landmark achievements in every field. It is a matter of great pride that our students have maintained the legacy of academic excellence year after year. This is displayed brilliantly by the fact that in the year 2019-20, a total of nearly 175 top 10 positions were bagged by our students in the Punjab University end semester examinations. The glory of our achievements in academics and cultural activities is well matched by our sportswomen who have won the Punjab University General Efficiency Sports Shield for a record 39 times and made their mark in national and international arenas as well. Equally glittering is a list of our alumni who have established themselves in positions of eminence and responsibility in diverse fields, both within India and abroad, as torchbearers and leaders worth emulating. Little wonder, therefore, that MCM has been ranked among the topmost colleges in the country by reputed national magazine India Today. Owing to its consistency in maintaining high standards of quality education and state-of-the-art infrastructural facilities, our college has been re-accredited with A grade by NAC and was also accorded the coveted Star College status by DBT. Ladies and gentlemen, MCM DAV College enjoys the rare distinction of being ranked first in the country in Swachh Campus Rankings 2018 under the Residential College category and was also placed third in India under Swachhta Sarvekshan 2019 in the Citizens-led initiatives. It is a matter of immense delight for us that ours is the only institution registered on the portal of National Skill Development Corporation as a skill provider. It has also been recognized under Vocational, Educational, Nayi Taleem, Experiential Learning, Action Plan Institution by the Ministry of Education, Government of India. Friends, our claim to eminence and leadership in the field of education is also endorsed by the fact that the college has been identified as a mentor institution by NAC to guide and conduct non-accredited colleges. Not only this, the Ministry of Education, Government of India, has nominated it as an institution with Swachhta Action Plan in 2020. More recently, in 2021, the Ministry of Food Processing Industries, Government of India, has nominated our college as the only educational institution in Chandigarh for providing training in bakery and food processing. Education, it is said, loses its relevance if it does not serve the society. Infused with the spirit of humanitarian service and social sensitivity, our NSS volunteers, NCC cadets, members of Rotaract Club, and other committees have offered their selfless social service and won accolades at various platforms. Equally noteworthy is our active and result-oriented participation in various national-level programs and schemes such as RUSA, Unnat Bharat, Ek Bharat Shresht Bharat, and others. It is indeed a matter of great honor that the Red Ribbon Club of the college has been declared the best in the country by the National AIDS Control Organization. Ladies and gentlemen, it goes without saying that such a level of merit and achievement in an institution cannot be reached without the dedicated efforts of the teaching faculty, the hard work of students, sincere cooperation of the support staff, and most importantly, the dynamism of the team leader. In the institutional quest for distinction, the IQAC, under the able guidance of Madam Principal and unflinching support of all stakeholders, has always been eager to initiate programs and activities aimed at enhancing the quality of education. This lecture today by an expert is another step in this direction. Ladies and gentlemen, kindly allow me to introduce you all to the distinguished speaker of the day. He is none other than Professor Parvinder Singh, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Riyad Bahra University, Mohali. A meritorious alumnus of the Punjab University, Chandigarh, Professor Singh has been a topper in BSc and MSc Chemistry. He did his MPhil with distinction and completed his doctorate in ultrasonic velocity studies, apart from acquiring a professional degree in LLB as well. His long and fruitful career in teaching that lasted nearly three decades started from DAV College, Sector 10, Chandigarh. Thereafter, he served at Government Science and Research College, Sector 10, Research College, Jabrao, and then joined the PG Government College for Girls, Sector 42, Chandigarh, as the head of the Department of Chemistry, prior to occupying several offices of administrative responsibility at the Punjab University. Ladies and gentlemen, during his tenure as the controller of examination for seven long years, Professor Singh initiated numerous significant reforms and introduced semester system at the undergraduate level. Equally commendable has been his contribution as a Dean, College Development Council, Deputy DPI and Registrar Examinations for 12 long years. During this period, he is credited with coordinating numerous national and state level examinations, including Indian Administrative Services, Punjab and Haryana Civil Services, NDA, CDS, Banking Services and Intelligence Bureau, to name just a few. Friends, a resource person has also rendered his invaluable services as a member of eminent academic bodies such as Punjab University Academic Council, Faculty of Science, and Board of Studies in Chemistry, to which he was elected multiple times, apart from being a member of American Chemical Society, USA, from 2004 and 8. Sir has also been an honorary editor of a UGC journal, Chemical Review, from 2006 to 2009. Professor Parvinder Singh exemplifies a perfect blend of administrative acumen and academic intelligence. This is evident from the fact that he has not only authored several textbooks on chemistry and published numerous research papers in reputed international and national journals, but has also presented papers in several international conferences held in Italy, Australia, USA, and Canada. Apart from contributing significantly as a member of several national level committees constituted by the Department of Higher Education, UGC, MHRD, NCTE, and others on issues pertaining to higher education, Professor Singh has also offered his expertise as a convener, coordinator, and resource person in numerous workshops on examination reforms, refresher courses, orientation courses, induction programs, and FDPs across the region. It is not surprising, ladies and gentlemen, that the achievements and contributions of such an erudite scholar should be recognized and rewarded. Not only was he a winner of merit scholarship as a student, but also bagged a prestigious fellowship from Australia for his PhD. Professor Singh, during his long and illustrious career, has been bestowed with numerous public awards for his contribution to higher education, such as Chandigarh Ratna, Award of Honor by All India Council of Principals, Global Excellence Teacher Award, and commendations from many trusts, managements, and organizations. More recently, as the Honorable Vice Chancellor of Riyad Bahra University, Mohali, Professor Singh has taken many bold initiatives to upgrade academic standards and bring qualitative change in all fields. Apart from conducting an academic audit for 30 departments, Sir has also signed 10 MOUs to pave the way for international internships and faculty exchange programs in his university. We are extremely grateful that despite his busy schedule, Professor Parvinder Singh has consented to deliver an online lecture on governance reforms, leadership and institutional management in the context of National Education Policy 2020 today. Sir, on behalf of the IQAC, the teaching faculty and the students of Meher Chand Mahajan DAV College for Women, Chandigarh, I extend a very warm welcome to you. But before I invite our distinguished speaker, I would request our principal, Dr. Nisha Bhargav, to kindly accord a formal welcome to Sir. Madam Principal, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bindu. Thank you for the generous introduction to the college and to our chief guest for today. Our esteemed guest speaker, Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Parvinder Singh Ji, Dr. Vibha Sharma, IQAC Chief Coordinator, Dr. Bindu Sharma, IQAC Coordinator, faculty members and very dear students. First of all, I extend a very warm welcome to Professor Parvinder Singh Ji, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Riyad Bahra University. Sir is a teacher, researcher, administrator, and human being par excellence. Prior to joining his current position as Vice Chancellor, Sir has served on various coveted positions, as Dr. Bindu has already elaborated upon, like the Controller of Examinations, Dean College Development Council, Registrar, Principal, DPI Colleges, Head of Department, and on many similar positions in Punjab University and other eminent institutions. He has been on various core academic bodies of Punjab University and other reputed universities all over the world. He has numerous research publications in reputed journals to his credit. And Sir has received a number of prestigious awards at national and international forums. Also, the credit for starting semester system at undergraduate level and for starting the innovative system of National Academic Depository in Punjab University goes to Sir. Today, Sir will be speaking on a topic of extreme contemporary relevance, that is governance reforms, leadership and institutional management concerning new education policy. Sir, we are deeply beholden to you for agreeing to deliver today's lecture for faculty members, researchers and students. I take this opportunity to express my deep sense of indebtedness to you for your guidance and support to our institution. Most importantly, we are grateful for your valuable time, which you have spared for us despite your extremely busy schedule today. I am sure that you will continue to guide us in future also. Further, I welcome all the participants who have joined today's event from far and wide. Sir, I feel very pleased to share that today we have received more than 1,000 registrations from across the nation and globe. The event is being live streamed on Google Meet as well as on YouTube. My gratitude is due to our internal quality assurance cell, which is being very ably led by Dr. Vibha Sharma and Dr. Bindu Sharma. Further, the entire organizing team and the technical team deserve credit for making it an event of national and international importance. Thanks everyone. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.
Thank you, ma'am. for your kind words. Now I would request Professor Parvinder Singh to kindly begin his lecture. Sir, please.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes,
yes, sir.
At the outset, I am very grateful to Professor Nisha ma'am, Principal ma'am, the sitting Senator of Punjab University, as well as the present member of the Senate, a very worthy colleague of myself particularly. I mean, we can share a lot on the academic front. And when she asked about the availability, I said I am always available for you. And of course, definitely for my colleagues, teacher colleagues, they are my strength. We are student, researchers, and students also. The theme which you have chosen, the credit goes to Dr. Bindu and Dr. Vibha, who are already known to me for a long time in the academic association. And now they are taking care of the IQAC, which is very important component for any institution, whether it is a college or it is a university. When I was in Punjab University, I never thought that the IQAC can play a pivotal role in the NAC accreditation or in other ranking of the university or the colleges. But honestly saying, I am there for about 1 year. I could not find even a single teacher who will head my IQAC. So I will request Madam Nisha, these two fantastic colleagues, Vibha and Bindu, they should be put on deputation to Riyadh Bara to take care of IQAC Riyadh Bara. So thank you very much for the pleasant journey of the MCM, which has been glorified by your elaborative explanation that how MCM came into existence and the roots of the MCM, which are well established now, and the institution which has grown to far off places all over the world. Everyone knows what is MCM. They may not be knowing Mir Chand Mahajan ji, but they know that MCM is something on the globe and on this part of the planet which is really admirable. And the academic excellence which you have proven, not for one, but for the decades. I watched the achievements of the MCM in the academics. Almost all the position in the academic when I was controller, I used to have doubt ki ye to nahi lagega ki madam sir ke no hone sari position MCM ko chali jati hai. But this was not true because the sports was also in the favor of MCM. Extracurricular youth festival will also go in your favor. NAG will go in your favor, and the skill development, vocational, you name anything. Whatever are the best practices which are given in the new education policy, you are already having the best practice. So I compliment all of you to the management, to the principal, to very vibrant faculty of the MCM, and the students who trust the institution that they only want MCM admission, MCM hostel, and MCM environment. So thank you very much. So I think we can talk about the topic. Topic is more relevant because with this new education policy, which is really full of challenges and expectation of the teachers, the policy which came into existence after more than 30 years, we could not think of how the reforms can take place. And we all as teacher, more than 20 years, more than 30 years in the colleges or in the university, we keep on talking about what are the difficulties, what are the challenges, and what should be done, what should not be done. So if we say that the knowledge of, that's the college and university, knowledge is power, and therefore it has remained the most important driving force sustaining the human existence. If you want to flourish the economy, to achieve the exponential economic growth, it is essential to gear up these skill-based activities through a very potential, vibrant, and dynamic higher education system. Of course, the system is very huge and complex, so there is a consensus need of the reforms which are not required, but they are imperative at the moment. Over the years, the trade, investment, mobility of the people and the places, economy have shown significant changes. But what about the revamping of the higher education that never came to the mind of the governments? So it is old and it is non-relevant at the moment. So look at the deficiencies in most of the key areas. So because we want the education, higher education must be accessible, it should be qualitative, it should be having proper finances, and then the perfect governance. A strategical paradigm shift in the policy framework has taken place. So overall functioning is needed to grow what is the expectation of the society needs. So I do have some presentations, some slides are there. If you can see, let me share. I need to share the, can I show my
No, sir, as of now we can't see.
Okay. Right, right. So then what we can do is can you hear me? This, can you hear?
Yes, sir.
We can hear.
Yes, okay. Governance reforms, leadership and institutional values, and considering as the best practices, I think entry into the quality higher education can open a vast era of possibilities. So the dynamics and the reasons of the exclusion of some development goals, particularly in the UN Charter, when you say that sustainable development goal, so it is a part of education charter. So we come across with the higher education sector, the approach of equity, inclusion in the education sector. So what is the challenge to the Indian university system? That's the governance issues, planning deficit, quality of teaching and research, faculty shortage, finances problem, academic and examination reforms, availability of the best higher education institution for the global ranking. So, but presently what has happened, there is a digital challenge to the governance of the institutions. Then the internationalization is another component of our education policy. Infrastructure revamping and reinventing, rebooting and redesigning the intent and content of the courses, and ultimately what is the meaningful education. So if we divide in different components, because I could not show my presentation, so I can summarize from here. The main theme of the new education policy is gross enrollment ratio. The university education along with the affiliated colleges, job market, placements, industry-oriented research, innovations, quality and the assessment of the best practices, financial support and the political interference to be minimized in the system. So if all these challenges are taken care, it may be another decade. We are having two important dates. One is 2030 and another is 2035. So the data which is available with us, and if we process this data to attain the information which should be converted in the knowledge domain. So ultimately, this knowledge, how knowledge will be transferred for the proper wisdom of the student. Now, what happens in the university or in the colleges, we talk about the promotion programs, but we know that there are many things which are governed by the government of India or by the state government or by the local administration. So the first part of the governance, leadership and management is, there must be a IQAC which ensures the vision and mission of the institution. As it is obvious from today's talk, it has to be disseminated to all the stakeholders. And they should ensure there is a system and the structure which should be through MIS, or we call it as e-governance regarding the financial management also. Now, measurements which are shown in the NEP or the different statistics have been discussed in the past. I talk about some of the graded accreditation can be possible. if the leadership of the highest quality, they promote the institution culture, making it to the potential of excellence. There are overreaching legislation which need to be superseded. As we have seen in the new education policy, all the stakeholders, they are impressing upon UGC should be dissolved, ACT should go, NCT should go. But the Higher Education Council of India, which is in the domain, will have many of the many verticals, particularly four verticals, which will be empowered to take care of the administration and the governance of the universities and the college. Now, these governance and leadership, they have the four basic points, which I must stress now. One, the basic component of education policy is the empowers global education to lead towards this sustainability. That is the first, which I understood from the NAP. And second is the engagement of the community. That is the student, staff, they involve the community for their sustainability. And then the governance makes sustainability strategic policy. Third component is the research, which is the transition of the survival of the institution. Any college, any university may not be able to survive if this component is not taken into account. And then all these three, if they are amalgamated, so they must have the operative part, which gives the positive social environment footprint to the society. Now, there is one very beautiful slide, but I cannot share. I can just list out few of the points which I have touched in this, in the governance reform. One is the teaching and training. Second is the social blended learning environment. Third is the assessment engine. Fourth is the micro learning. Then it is a curation studio. Curation studio means we should have the artificial intelligence, simulations, 3D, ARs, all these. And then the main part of this diagram, which I will pass on to Principal Madam to share with you, is going to be integration with the virtual platform. This is not the present COVID-19, but going to be the life of the higher education. Seamless integration with the virtual platform, all the tools which we are using. Let us have something in the curriculum and competencies. We need to come out of the conservative teaching, which I had undertaken, which you have already done. But let us start adding some component, 10%, 20%, 30%, so that the teachers, they become learner, and then they deliver to the students. Now, what is required immediately is all the institutions, they must realize what is the vision, so that they empower the student, not for the pursuit of knowledge, but for delegating the values and the social responsibility. Distinctive approach toward the comprehensive vision, that is in the form of service to the society, or by certification, or by allowing students to develop skills, multidisciplinary, entrepreneurship, ethical human values. So they are the need of our. So in this context, one very important component which struck to my mind, that is the, we are not taking care of the gender equity and the sensitization. We just treat it as a statutory requirement UGC has given us. So we will keep it in mind. We have made a sexual harassment cell. So please, if we have to have the perfect governance reform, I think let us make this as mandatory. Gender-based violence, sexual violence, exploitation, harmful practices, vulnerability exploitation, dependency, poverty, inequality, discrimination, everything has to be thrown in the drain. Then you can start doing the governance reform. Now, we know that there is a provision of all these categories, and minimum we are doing, but we need to understand the gender equity. And the second part of the policy, if you read it carefully, it pertains to the environment consciousness also. That is also one of the key factor for the sustainability of the education. This environment consciousness is with regard to the environment attitude, how we have, how we behave, and then the environment values which are inherited to us, and then the environment motives, what we preach, and then the environment knowledge. So that makes the environment ecosystem for any institution. That is also one of the governance reform. Governance reform is, to me, it is not that let us change the UGC, let us change the affiliating bodies, let us change the regulatory bodies, but it is the reforms which can implement the NEP. So if you talk about the environment consciousness, we all know that, I will say, we have solar energy, we have biogas, we have sensor-based energy conservation, we have the environment auditing, and we have the power efficient equipment. So they may not be the component of sustainable development. What is required, that is important. So then the related part is the how we treat the waste management. So whether it is a landfill or the recycling or it is a harvesting of the rainwater or the storage and collection, so they also contribute to something and something. Disposable of the degradable, non-degradable waste, this should also be taken into account. So water conservation facilities, they are must for the survival. And as you were saying that you have got the Swachh Bharat survey award, and this is one of the very encouraging feature for the accreditation, for the perfection towards the governance reform. So you have the green campus, you restrict the automobiles, you encourage the student to take care of the environment, ban the plastics or the eco-friendly environment, paper landscaping with trees and plants. So this is all what are the initiatives which are being there. So what I mean is the qualitative audit of the environment with respect to energy, it must be done regularly. In terms of the production, consumption of the energy, of the renewable sources. So clean and green campus, they are the initiative of MCM, and that is why you are being encouraged by the government, by the state, and by the national agencies. So after this, there is a inclusion and situatedness. So, if this word seems to be different, situatedness is, I have tried personally in Rialpara, we are having about 700-800 students from Jammu and Kashmir with Kashmiri culture, from interior Kashmiris, from the disturbed areas of Kashmir. But when we asked them what you want, they said we are cut off from our culture. In February 2021, there was one event which was named as Allah. I asked the artists from the valley to come. So they stayed, they had a wonderful performance. So we have included this, that the situatedness means to promote the heritage culture of the student who are with you. We in Punjab, we can deliver the Punjabi, we can give the Punjabis or Haryanvis, but if you are having from the Rajasthan or from the Odisha, from the northern eastern states, so situatedness, that gives the positive vibes to the institution, and you can be the role model for inclusion and the situatedness. So in this case, you will have to have understand what is the regional linguistic and the communal socio-economic values. So you can arrange the sports, you can have the culture, you can commemorate their days. So provide them the space so that they don't feel they are the racial and they connected with their cultural values. Then let us have proper redressal system in the colleges or in the universities. Minimum, as you are having student grievance redressal, sir. In Punjab University, I started with EGSMS, that is the Examination Grievance Monitor System. I don't know whether it's working now. So there were 11 type of grievances which affiliated colleges student will come. They were very small, common, and immediate redressal was provided within 24 hours. Like they have the correction of the name, duplicate roll number, provisional degree, a fees defaulter, all these issues which were to be sent by the colleges. I think Madam Principal can endorse my this statement. So they were sent through online, whether it was through VPN or through the EGMS. So we had a well-established grievance monitor system. So follow the code of ethics for the student and for the teachers, for the employees to value their regional communal diversities. So then another is that there are some constitutional obligation. This why I'm talking, because they are the part of your perfection towards the leadership, that you must have the legal awareness, constitutional obligations. They must be understood. Unity and diversity of our motherland, it must be adopted, not in words, but it should be reflected in the daily deeds of the student and of the teachers. Inculcating the values so that they become the responsible citizen, not ordinary graduate, but the overall holistic personality is groomed in that way. So then I think if I take my personal advice or personal remarks, let's have the handbook of code of conducts for students separately, teachers, manuals and the brochures, including the professional ethical program, which are transmitted by the UGC or by Ministry of Education, so that they are valued and some feedback is given to the higher authorities. So with the present scenario, what we are feeling as parents, as teacher, as administrator, as a policymaker, the humanity is reflected. There is a decline. We talk, as parent I talk, there is a decline in the moral values or in the qualities. But we say that new education policies stress upon the preserved and protected values to become the responsibility of the organization. You should not be only academic organization, but a social organization also, so that you revive and reframe these values. Education institutions, right from the beginning, from the basic education to the tertiary education to the university level, they are the only sole responsible for important and leading role in maintaining the human values. So recognizing the importance of human values, ethics, so that is one of the very important component of new education policy. So that means what we need to have the personal ethics, moral ethics, principles, and then comes the professional ethics. So being in the university or in the colleges, it is our collective duty to adhere to the rules of the higher education. Now, we do celebrate many of the national, international days, events, festivals, and mark the respect for them. So, but the patriotism and ethnic and the geographical differences, they should not be in our celebrations. So what are the best practices? Because MCM doesn't need any guidance with this regard, but the best practice is maintaining the quality, proper solution of a difficult situation towards success with strategy, with the skill development framework. Earlier in our pedagogy, we used to say, let's have the scientific temperament, but I think now it is the skill development strategical planning. You have already taken lead by introducing a few courses, and they are not affiliated with the Punjab University, but they are affiliated with the vocational department of government or by the different agencies. So that needs the commendable appreciation by all of us. And that should be branded also to pan India. Everyone should know that if MCM can do, if this college can do in one part of the country, why not it is disseminated to the other part of the country. Now, when I talk about some best practices, which a few of them I have listed, one very, very, very important component is the community service, so that we realize our social responsibility. So it is the CSR also, it is the ERP also, that the involvement of the social activities. And just for your small information, on every Saturday, Riyad Para teachers who are with the nursing, with the physiotherapy, because we are having more than 150 courses, so all paramedical courses, dental department. So I have asked them to go in the villages. So every Saturday, team of 50 plus volunteers. So they go to the villages, they provide the community service, they take care of their health, and they make a diary of them, ask them to come to the university, ambulance is sent to them or private vehicles are sent to them, so that their health, hygiene and their moral, psychological, all parts, all issues, they are taken care of by my team. And my teacher who are going for this thing, they really appreciate that. We feel contented by end of the day. And the earlier I used to convince them, but what has happened now, everyone is trying, next week will be my visit, next will be my visit. So I think this type of awareness, if every institution, every university, college adopts, so we can serve our people, citizens who cannot afford to come to the cities or the hospitals to purchase medicine or to purchase their rations, etc. Their kids have been all settled in overseas, so they want to connect them. So these things are very small, but they are really paying for this social activity and for community service. So to me, I think instead of donating something to temple or gurdwara, it's better to donate our time and energy for the welfare of the society. So then the second best practice I can say is the soft skills and the personality development program. There should be some project-based learning. We have started, but there may be some compulsion hurdles for the affiliated colleges of the Punjabi or Guru Nanak University. But we need to have project-based learning. Let us come out of the conservative and the old tradition teaching modules. So then the research motivation practice must start from the graduation itself. You cannot ask MA ke baad mereko job nahi mili to maine socha PhD karna. So this type of attitude needs to be changed. So research, that is why there are two types of degrees in the NEP. One is 3 year and one is a 4 year. So the policy maker, they have thought of the good things. So it is we, whether we contradict the policy or we adopt the policy and we take the best extract of the policy. So then one point which always attract me, that is a woman empowering program. It should not only be in the girls' college, but in our counterparts also. This program, it must be added in the curriculum, that the women empowerment program, they are missing. Till date they are missing. We talk a lot, we talk loud also, but on the ground reality, what is happening, we all know. So then another is, in the best practices which are implemented, you do have the training and replacement cell, environment friendly practices. So then because digital technology is taking over, so I think immediately we should go for the digitalization and digitization. These two different words, digitalization and digitization. So the libraries or the other data, it should be ERP based or it should be digital based. Then I will request to Principal Madam, please do have some courses or funded courses for the staff. Let us support them. Let us promote them so that a teacher who is involved in the academic and the extracurricular activities, they must be given some benefit, some incentive for their professional development. Professional development will be like you can have online course from Cambridge University or from Oxford University. So that the online certification, if some nominal fees is to be paid, you please owe them that your teachers, they after 6 months, they say that the while serving in MCM, I got the certification from the Cambridge or from Oxford or from Stanford or from some Harvard, etc. So please think over this thing, the professional development. And then what are the key performance indicator in this whatever we are discussing? What is the evaluation? Whether we are under surveillance, whether we are under the radar of evaluation, which is very difficult. Evaluation of the performance, so that becomes one very important indicator. Then when you fix the goal, we understand that whether the optimization is taking place. If optimization is not there, then there is a strategy how to achieve the goal. without goal, there is no syllabus, there is no curriculum, there is no planning. So to obtain a goal, there is an optimization of the goal, and then the strategical planning is there. Finally, for the higher education stakeholders or for the policymaker or the administrator, so it is the analytical approach, and which is toward the higher side of the growth, and that results in the implementation of the components or policy or document. Now, what is required for the distinctiveness in the institution? When you have research, innovation, skill development, academy-industry interface. So this is also a new term which is impressing upon every one of us, that for the information of my learner league, I have started 50 new courses in Riyadhbara after my joining, and these 50 courses, most of them, they are linked with the industry. I have asked industry, my teachers, my deans, my HODs, we have asked industry people to give us a syllabus, to give us a curriculum. So in a way, they are the tailor-made courses, but being adopted by the Riyadhbara, and we are catering the need, academic needs, and the training part is being taken care of by the industry, local industry or some other industry. Just before this lecture, I got a message from Pune film industry. Our 11 students, they are in the Pune film industry, and they are doing marvelously excellent. In last 2 years, they were studying over here, but they were not aware how the film is being made, how the photographs are. So I will share those photographs with Madam Nisha, principal. Just I got at 11:50. So that type of linkage is required. We are delivering, industry is wanting something different. We are not on the same page, and ultimately it is resulting in the unemployment. So the career center of your institution can connect with the industry experts from the different areas. You have the wonderful alumni with you, your mentors, your management people, they can arrange these type of experts. So this is required for the institutional distinctiveness. And then the scholarship scheme, we must have over and above than the government scholarship scheme. Our students, particularly those who are BPL, I'm not using the word, SC should be given scholarship, ST should be given scholarship. Any person from the general category, anywhere pan India, if they want to study in MCM, let us have number of seats for them, promote them, they will become really the future of the country. So 24/7 emergency services should be available. And then the national and international accreditation of the institution as well as the staff achievement, they must be highlighted. Our number of teachers, they get the awards by the organizations, whether they are the public, private, trust, journal, or some sponsored rotary, etc., whatever it is, they must become the face of the institution. Then audiovisual and the e-classroom, they are the need of ours. You cannot run the college and the university without the audiovisual laboratories, with the classrooms, e-classrooms. It's a new concept coming, e-classroom. And then the online...
Excuse me, sir. Your voice is cracking a little bit.
The ongoing... Is it okay? Ongoing commitment...
Yes, if you're not properly audible.
Hello. So, is some disturbance on that side or from this side? Hello.
Excuse me, sir. It's still not audible. Bindu, I think the problem is in your mic or something. Sir is just all right. I think he's speaking all right.
Hello? It's clearly audible here.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Okay. So, I was just finishing with the institutional distinctiveness. And coming to the last part of our discussion, which is the skill-oriented competency of the staff, training of the teachers, and the utilization of the experienced teachers and their ability to participate in the on different fronts. So then what is the growth rate of the institution? If it is not there, then let us have the advanced training. And for this, I think all institutions, they must have, in addition to the quality assurance cell, independent accreditation cell, R&D cell, So finally, the educational supply chain, if we say, what is the input? Input is the internal and external resources. Students, they are coming to the university, they are coming to the colleges, they are the raw material. So I am talking on a commercial diagram. So the supplied input, that is the raw and the crude stuff, students, internal, external, coming for the processing, passing through the 2 or 3 or 5 year curriculum, going out with the research, going out as a graduate, going out of the university or colleges as a postgraduate. So what is the consumption? Consumer will become the society. So who is to provide the finished project? That is important. So these were the main points which I wanted to share with you. So ultimately, what will be the best governance? Best governance will be the scenario of the changing India over the couple of years. Externally redesigned higher education is there. So that is the governance reform. So the absence of violence, government effectiveness, regulatory equality, quality, rule of law, control of corruption in the education institutions. So then the evaluate of the governance in the education, incentive to the service provider and relationship with regard to the stakeholder, and then ultimately the fiscal performance, that will be known as the resources are allocated, they are reallocated, they are managed, they are actually used. So I think that is required. So what will be the standards? Standards are the transparent and they are publicly known. Incentives are financial and non-financial. Information is by the government in the clear terms with the accurate data, and accountability has to be fixed of the public officials or by the service provider. So immediately we will be requiring the underpins and the supports, the mission and the purposes of the institutions. Without such, the intent and the purpose of the institution, that will be failing. Good governance must cater the sound, ethical, sustainable, acceptable ideas as a whole, and then finally as a stakeholder. Good governance oversees the implementation of the strategical planning with well-considered processes, procedure, open, transparent and honest manner. Then the finally, I can say, accept the inequality, own collective, individual responsibility, not the boards of governance. So, to me, I think, if we see the model of the Punjab University colleges, let's say MCM versus Punjab University. First is, we need to have the license to grant degree, accreditation of the quality benchmarking, disbursement of the public funds, regulation of the access, provision of the practice or doing this thing. So some of the parts like the award of degree, that's under section 22 of UGC, it is with the university. But rest of the part, the quality assurance, affiliation, courses, that lies with the receiver, that is a college. So two types of the governance are there, governance at the level of the college, governance at the level of the university. So the perfection will be the amalgamated best education idea, policy, and transferring from top to bottom, which is traveled down the channel. So that will be, I think, best. In the last, I must say that it is not the dream which you see when you are sleeping. It is not the dream, but it is a dream which does not allow you to sleep. That rightly said by Dr. Abdul Kalam ji. And the education is the strongest weapon, as said by Nelson Mandela, which can take care of the society. So I think I have enough to deliver. So thank you very much for your patience hearing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. We are obliged.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. And it's a matter of immense pride for us to have you amongst us. And your expert views and vision on this issue has truly enriched our knowledge regarding national education policy and its various dimensions, and the importance of the good governance, effective leadership and the institutional management, which you have discussed in detail. And the most significant thing which you have told us is the kind of social footprint which we leave on the society and the community around us. And we highly appreciate the kind of commendable work your faculty members are doing under your able leadership to reach out the communities around them. So we highly appreciate it. And your exemplary achievements in the field of administration and academics is really motivating all of us, each one of us. And thank you very much once again for giving such an enlightened session on this topic. And now I'm opening this virtual portal for an interactive session. And dear participants, you are requested to post your queries. Either you can ask in person or you can post your queries in the chat box if you have any questions. Yes, is there any query? Sir, I just want to, yes, I think there is one person who wants to ask something. Yes. Yeah, please, you can unmute yourself. Yes, yes, there is one question raised by Adya. Okay, dear, you can unmute yourself. She has raised the hand. Yes, or you can write in the chat box. Okay, sir, I think the students are just, thinking about the queries. I just want to ask one thing, that could you please suggest some policies or some projects or some steps for the welfare of the staff and teachers? Because I think that is also a very important component of the present national education policy, that it aims at a very comprehensive kind of development and comprehensive kind of equality in the society.
I think, if you recall, I said specifically the colleges like MCM, they must be the trendsetter and they should create benchmark. Let's have the online certification from US, from UK or from Canada, so that one professional incentive is given to each other. Professional incentive can be given. These modules are of $20 to $100 for 6 weeks or for 8 weeks. So this can really polish the professionalism among the teachers, because this era is of the digital technology. We are almost ending our academic professional career. After 2 years, 5 years, we may not be in the college or in the university, but the pace of the digital technology, that's a very exponential. We need to be updated with the recent developments in the technology. Any kind of the certification where you can take the lead, so that your students, they can convey in the public or to the parent that my teacher has recently got the degree from USA.
I think sir has lost the internet link. Yes, sir, you're not audible, sir. Okay, dear participants.
I think there's a connection ka problem hai, ma'am.
Yeah, I think we will wait for just few minutes. I think maybe in few seconds he will rejoin. Yes, yes, he's there.
Who can be given this opportunity to understand is the best going all over the world. This crisis, COVID-19, has taught so many lessons which we never thought 2 years back. Our teachers, they never thought how to have the online examination. What is the blended model? And now we are in that fix, whether to have the offline class or to have the online class. So, online meetings, online everything. So I think something can be done. And number two, for the new education policies, teacher should start. Me, if I am given chance as a Ministry of Education, which I don't think it possible, all teachers should be given the benefit of the consultancy. We give so many advice, we give so many lectures to our society or to the or the student, but some part can be as the commercial incentive. Let's say that on Sunday, this teacher is available for the career counseling. parents are going to the professional counselors, and these professional counselors, they are graduate with some certification from private organization. The teacher of the MCM, the principal of the MCM, or the management MCM, no one can be the best counselor than these type of stuff. So why this counseling is not adopted as the part of the profession? This is number two. Number three is that why not start uploading your lectures on the YouTube or on the MOOCs, or so that this type of monetary incentive is transferred directly to the teachers. And fourth is, you design some curriculum for the foreign universities. Overseas universities, they really appreciate the hard work of the Indian teacher. So let us look into this aspect also, that if you design something for them, so they are returned as the royalty. Everything, whatever you work, you get. So these type of the monetary incentives are there, but we need to extract to the best of that. I know SP College teachers, they are involved teaching in the Fraser Valley University, and they get very good honorarium for this thing. So similarly, many universities who are established by Indians in Canada or in Australia, they need loyal and hardworking teachers. Let us do this thing. So this is my personal, right?
Thank you very much, sir, for giving such an elaborate answer and satisfying this query. So now I invite Dr. Vibha Sharma. She wants to ask one question to you, sir.
My connection is just gone. Sir, I want to ask a question that in affiliated colleges, we do have constraints of the syllabus. And we would like to have certain courses where the students are made employable, skillful and employable. Yes, we do have our own courses like add-on courses and other courses. But my question is that universities should also arise and arrive to this occasion that they need to make a syllabus which is employable and skill-oriented. So how do we do that, and how do we expect the universities to do so?
Dr. Vibha, I think this is a very crucial question and very pertinent. If you can just recall what I said, in my university, I started 50 courses. They are tailor-made by the industry. So Punjab University governing body is a highly democratic body. This is only university where you can present your views. Only thing is the enforcement. You are in the board of studies, you are in the academic council, you are in the faculties, you are in the senate, syndicate. So their mindset may not be that versatile as you are having, because you are interacting with the student on the ground realities. Punjab University student need something immediately passing out from the campus or from the affiliated college. MCM is not less than MCM or DV or bigger colleges who are the A-graded colleges. They are not anything less than the university itself. Honestly, confessional statement is, after 2 years, you will not have any difference as per the NEPU, what is Punjab University and what is MCM College. You will have your own identity. You will survive only and only if qualitative transfer of knowledge or the sharing of knowledge is done by the college. Otherwise, without performance, institution will start perishing. They will sink. Bigger university, you can get in writing from a bigger institution, whatever the university may be, they will ultimately sink and they will not able to survive. And who will be the competitor? MCM or the private universities or the private sector. As we have seen, Professor Arun Grover used to say, there was a time when the government schools were in demand, then the government colleges were in demand. Do you have this craze now? Same will happen to the tertiary education, to the universities. If you see Punjab universities flanked by Chitkara's, Chandigarh universities, now MIT is coming, Riyadbara, and do you know that how many strength we are getting nowadays? It runs 10 times than the Punjab University. Punjab University 17,000, Chandigarh University 27,000, MIT touching 2,000, Riyadhbar already crossed 9,000, then Chitkara is already with 10,000. So see, this type of people are realizing, student of the Chandigarh, they are going in the Chandigarh University, people are going in the Riyadh, people are going in the MIT. They want the latest technology, they want the latest levels. And this is your question reply, that any university or any college, if they are not updated, if you are still teaching the same thing which you learned as a student, you are not to be admired in the society. Student will say, madam ne wahi padhaya jo khud padhte the. Agar wahi purane notes ke saath aaj bhi class mein aaoge, student will not welcome. Student, they are more knowledgeable than us. Only thing is, their energy, their knowledge is to be channelized by the teacher only. That is why I say that the teacher must be updated digitally also. So that if they say ki mere paas yahan se maine download kiya, aapko maine to usse bhi upar karke diya. And for me, I don't feel very obliged ki main vice chancellor hoon. I talk with Mr. Rajneesh and the UGC secretary, a very small note, and then I will end up. That sir, don't appoint vice chancellor at the age of 60, appoint the vice chancellor at the age of 45. 45 is a young mind who can learn the technology, who can lead the university. 60, you cannot lead the university. At the 60, you will be part of the bigger and the bigger politics. You will have your own groups. You will not be academic leader. We need to have academic, digitally trained leader. So this is required. Jo syllabus ki baat aap karte, what you say, you are to frame. You are to say that this syllabus is for next 3 years. We are not to say ki pichle 5 saal se ye chal raha hai. And the same type of the teachers are in the university and in the colleges. They don't want to change the syllabus. They don't want to adopt the new content. Because it is, they don't want to come out of the comfort zone. So moment you change your mindset, no one can stop you. No senate, no, madam is here with all respect, no senate syndicate will say ki ye syllabus naya hai, isko humne adopt nahi karna. They are the simply vetting councils. They are the vetting bodies. The groundwork is to be done by the board of study and take the in writing from the student ki hame kya chahiye, aapko wo dene padega ban jata. Right?
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Is there any other queries? Yes, dear participants, if you have any question, any queries, please feel free to ask. Or you know, write in the chat box, and if right now some questions are not coming in your mind, then later on we will pass on your questions to the sir, and we will try to select the answers from sir and let you know.
Okay, dear participants, I just request
all of you to please switch on your cameras for a second so that we can have a memorable pick of this event.
Yes, dear participants,
all are requested to please switch on your cameras for a while.
Yes, dear students, please. Okay. Thank you very much, dear participants.
Yes, there are a lot of questions coming
to us regarding
your insight on this topic. And now I request my coordinator, Dr. Vibha Sharma, to extend a formal vote of thanks.
Over to
Dr. Vibha Sharma.
Thank you, Bindu.
Thank you, Bindu.
Very good afternoon to all.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Reforms infuse new direction and re-energize a sector to achieve the goals of development. And sir, reforms were long overdue in the education sector. Our worthy Prime Minister has also stated that reforms are needed for development, new order and new facilities. And definitely, sir, we need to make education socially relevant as well as employable. On behalf of IQAC, faculty, the students of MCM Dev College, Chandigarh, I propose a vote of thanks to you, sir, Professor Parvinder Singh, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Riyadh and Bahra University, Mohali, for your enlightening address on governance reforms, leadership, and institutional management in context of National Education Policy 2020. We will certainly keep an opportunity to thank Madam Principal for encouraging the IQAC to organize such sessions. I also thank the organizing team, a success. Thank you, sir, and thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for your high words. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks to everyone.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. And thank you, Dr. Vibha Sharma, for extending formal vote of thanks. And I just want to extend formal thanks to all the participants and to the organizing team for organizing this event. And our heartfelt gratitude to Professor Pavinder, sir, for taking out time from his busy schedule and giving us valuable insight on this topic. Thank you very much. And I request all the participants to now leave the session. And now we will end this session. Thank you very much. Take care and have a nice day.